Hello everyone, I am the Medic Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on a commander from Commander 2021, Osgear the Reconstructor. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. The best way you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. For just $1, patrons get early access to certain videos on YouTube. In fact, patrons get a chance to see this video earlier. You can also support my channel for free by simply liking, subscribing, and sharing, which also helps out a lot. You can find all pertinent links down in the description. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Osgear is a 4-4 giant artificer with vigilance for 2 generic, 1 red, and 1 white. Osgear has 2 activated abilities that synergize with each other. For his first one, you pay 1 and sacrifice an artifact to give a creature you control +2/+0 until end of turn at instant speed. This can be used in response to a beater getting through in order to potentially kill off an opponent. However, this can also just be used as a very cheap and reliable sacrifice outlet, especially with his second activated ability. For X, tapping and exiling an artifact from your graveyard, you create 2 tokens that are copies of that artifact. Unfortunately, you can only activate this at sorcery speed, but even then it's quite a powerful ability. Even the drawbacks aren't that bad since this deck will do a great job of circumventing them. Essentially, Osgear is a better foil than Andoretti, in my opinion at least, since you still have a recursion aspect but with an additional color. Since we want to make the most of Osgear's ability, we want to copy it as often as we can. The artifact is getting exiled, so we might as well. Equipping Osgear with Battle Mage's Bracers and Illusionist's Bracers copies his activated abilities. Yes, this means that his first ability essentially gives a creature we control +4/+0, but, more importantly, is going to create 4 copies of the exiled artifact instead of just 2. Keep in mind that since the sacrifice and exile are part of their respective activation costs and not part of the effect, copying them with these equipment means we get double the benefit without any of the drawback. Having both equipped on Osgear quadruples the results of his activated abilities. If you want to do something really spicy, sacrifice one of them, then recur with Osgear, then equip both token copies for even more madness. We can also copy his abilities with Rings of Brighthearth and Lithiform Engine. Unfortunately, we do have to pay mana each time, but it's worth it to get 4 copies of whatever artifact we're exiling, especially since there'll be mana rocks, beaters, utility, etc. So having as many copies of amazing artifacts will seal our victory all the sooner. The engine also has the potential of copying any triggered ability, instant, sorcery, or permanent spell we have on the stack, so it's even more useful beyond synergizing with Osgear. Besides Osgear, we can also perform some recursion hijinxes with Felden of the Third Path, Goblin Welder, Duretti Scrap Savant. The Duretti precon also introduced Felden, which is an amazing card as well, plus a reprint of Goblin Welder. That was an amazing commander precon. Anyways, each of these permanents help us continue recurring things from our graveyard. Both Goblin Welder and Duretti can swap an artifact in play for one in the graveyard, which is amazing at bypassing those pesky high casting costs. Felden creates an artifact token copy of any creature in our graveyard without exiling it, making the ability repeatable. Also, the token is sacrificed at the end of the turn and not exiled, meaning that we can also abuse and reuse the death triggers of any creatures that have them. Mirage Mirror is a great utility artifact on theme with the copying aspect of the deck. Use it to copy any of the bracers, a beater, a utility artifact, an enchantment, and not just ours, but opponents as well. Since it's an artifact in the graveyard, we can recur with Osgear to be able to double the insanity and utility. However, as I mentioned in the beginning, having to exile the artifact can end up being quite the drawback. That's why my favorite recursion effect is in the deck, which is Sunforger. Now, if this seems odd, you're not wrong. Sunforger isn't a recursion effect. However, besides being able to cheat any instant we have in the deck, since they're all less than 4 mana, it cheats the most important one, Pull from Eternity. This instant sends any face-up card we have in exile to the graveyard. This allows us to keep recurring it with Osgear or with Duretti or Goblin Welder or Felden if it was an artifact creature. However, this is just an instant, so we can only do this once, right? That's where the final piece of the puzzle, Mistvale Plains, comes in. If we control another white permanent besides Osgear, we're able to activate this land to bottom deck Pull from Eternity from the graveyard. With it once more in our library, we can cheat it from there with Sunforger. With this engine, we don't really lose any artifact with exiling with Osgear. Since this is a bit slow, Pierce Seal Paladin and Brass Squire are also included in the deck. Sunforger costs 3 to equip and 2 to activate, which can add up. The Paladin allows us to equip it for free since we will have Metalcraft active when the Squire can tap to equip it at instant speed. These might seem a bit niche, but recall that we're also running the 2 bracers we saw earlier, as well as some protective equipment we're going to see soon. These make this Sunforger engine much faster. Another way to retrieve our exiled artifacts is with Karn the Great Creator. Unfortunately, the wish effect of the ability doesn't work in Commander due to Rule 11, but we can still get an exiled artifact back into our hand. This might be a bit slow if we're returning an artifact with a huge casting cost, since we'd rather cheat it into play, but the point is that we can recover one without losing Karn, since it costs just 2 loyalty to do so. He can also animate an artifact to gain loyalty, which isn't that bad if we have an expensive artifact in play. However, his static ability is another amazing reason for running Karn, which is quite the bonus. On its own, it's going to shut down opponents' mana rocks, treasure tokens, equipment, etc. But with Mycosynth Lattice, we can practically shut down all of our opponents' decks. Not only does Mycosynth Lattice work amazingly well in our deck by making all of our permanent artifacts in play and colorless everywhere else, but we can use mana as if it were any color. Granted, most of our spells and effects are colorless, but the deck is running 10 basics due to the synergy, so this can also help out with color fixing. Triumphant Reckoning is another amazing recursion effect in the deck, albeit quite costly. However, this spell is amazing when combined with a sacrifice outlet. We can sacrifice all of our artifacts for value, cast it, then get them back all over again. This spell can also help us recover our enchantments and planeswalker, which aren't a lot, but we'll still be able to gain them back, which is important. As I mentioned earlier, some of the things we want to be copying and recurring are beaters. Although Karn plus Mycosynth Lattice is pretty much game over due to the table scooping in our favor, Beatdown is the main win con of our deck. Being able to recur either Wyrmcoral Engine, Phyrexian Triniform, and Triplicate Titan can spell trouble for our opponents. They might be expensive to cast, but the deck has a ton of ways to discard cards for value, so we don't even need to cast these first, we can get them straight from the graveyard. My favorite thing about these huge beaters is that they have a death trigger, so if we later sacrifice them for value, we get tokens of them in pieces, or if we created tokens of them with Thalden, then they blow up and create these tokens at the beginning of our end step. The Triniform is especially busted since we can choose to Encore it instead if we have the mana. This will create a token copy for each opponent and then is sacrificed at the end of our turn. With our trusty Pull from Tomorrow Sunforger engine, we can potentially pull this off very frequently if we have the mana, which we should since we can also copy mana rocks. Quintoria's Field Historian synergizes further with our beatdown strategy since he creates a 3-2 spirit token whenever a card leaves our graveyard, a token that's actually 4-2 since he pumps up our spirits by +1/+0. What's great about Quintoria's is that we can recover cards from our graveyard which triggers him, not just by exiling, so he'll trigger off of Mistveil Plains as well. And in order to further the value, Anointed Procession is going to double all the tokens we're creating. It should be no surprise then that this is pretty much an auto-include here. However, keep in mind that we're also running Mirage Mirror. If we have more copies of that, we can turn them into Anointed Procession before we start creating tokens in order to really push our knowledge of exponents. So I hope you paid attention in your Algebra 1 class. Haunfrey Ghost Forge also creates tokens but only when our non-token creatures die. This is still great because it provides a sort of protection from spot removal or board wipes since he creates a token copy of the creature that died. With the way his trigger works, the creature dies and is then exiled, meaning it hits the graveyard first and then leaves it, which triggers Quintoria's too, so mind your triggers. Then, if that spirit copy token were to leave the battlefield for whatever reason, your exiled creature goes to your graveyard. I bet you can already imagine all the shenanigans that can ensue, especially with Anointed Procession on the battlefield. However, if it's an artifact creature that died, we can then copy with Osgur when it returns to the graveyard, copy with Thalden, or swap it with Duretti or Golan Welder. There's just so many things you can juggle and do with all the engines in the deck, especially considering how so many of them overlap. Haunfrey also pairs amazingly well with Pia's Revolution. This enchantment also works well on its own, but even if an opponent has you return the artifact creature to your hand, Haunfrey still creates the token copy. But this enchantment is simply busted here, especially if we're able to sacrifice a ton of non-token artifacts. There will come a point when an opponent will be too low on life to say no and you'll be able to recur your artifacts from your hand instead of your graveyard. And if those artifacts end up costing zero, you're going to essentially have an infinite engine going on with the potential of killing off the table. You can't kill them off with Pia's Revolution since your opponent's not taking damage is what's getting the artifact back into your hand, but creating an infinitely large creature with Osgur is pretty much the way to go with this effect. But let's see how we're going to reduce those casting costs and effects. Recall that the other downside of Osgur's abilities is how expensive it can be to reanimate bigger creatures and artifacts. That isn't a problem though if we're able to reduce the cost of his activated ability with cards like Hearthstone and Zerda the Dawnwaker. Unfortunately, the deck has too many amazing permanents without activated abilities in order to use Zerda as a companion, but it's fine since we can still run it in the 99. Zerda goes one further than Hearthstone by reducing Osgur's ability by 2. That isn't just for Osgur either, but all activated abilities. So Zerda is also helpful with equip costs and the activation costs of our other creatures and artifacts. As a bonus, it can also be used to prevent a creature from blocking one of our beaters, which is definitely a huge plus considering that Osgur himself can pump that creature for the potential knockout. Hearthstone can obviously be abused if we're able to copy it with Osgur's own ability first, since it's an artifact, so just imagine it with all the other token copy and ability copy effects I mentioned at the beginning. We can also just reduce the cost of our artifact spells per se thanks to Foundry Inspector, Joris Familiar, Starnheim Cursor, and Ugin the Ineffable, two of these being artifact creatures, so they can be copied with Osgur to further reduce the cost of our expensive artifacts, making the deck even faster. You'd be surprised how fast and how ahead this deck can get considering it's red-white. Hugin takes it a step further by reducing the cost of our colorless spells by 2 generic. Remember Mycosith Lattice making our cards colorless outside of the battlefield? Well, combined with Hugin, he'll then reduce the cost of all of our spells by 2. His plus ability is also useful in providing a token as well as slow card advantage. His minus 3 is pretty useful at destroying any color permanent, but actually non-bows with Mycosith Lattice in our opponent's favor, so keep that in mind. The familiar also reduces the cost of our legendary spells, which is good since there's a couple of them in the deck besides Ozgur and the other ones we've seen. The Pegasus also reduces the cost of our enchantments, which is more of a nice bonus than anything since the deck only has 6 enchantments. But it's also a 2-2 flyer for 3 mana, so there's that. In fact, half of those enchantments are for synergistic mana acceleration, land tax, monologue tax, and smothering tithe. Not only does land tax thin the deck of lands while also getting us up to 3 basic in one hand, but that can also fuel our rummaging and looting effects and spells that help us dig deeper through our library. Monologue tax and smothering tithe are quite ubiquitous, but are even better here since they create artifact tokens. Tokens that can be multiplied with Anointed Procession, sacrificed with Ozgur, swapped out with Duretti or Goblin Welder, etc. Besides the normal use of just accelerating our mana. Crucible of Worlds is an artifact-based way of further accelerating our mana. Not only can it play those basics we dished after getting with land tax, but we can also reuse any of the 8 fetch lands in the deck. Since it is an artifact, we can make the most of it and sacrifice it later for better value if need be, etc. However, another amazing use for Crucible of Worlds, besides its synergy with land tax and the fetch lands, is the 3 artifact lands, Darksteel Citadel, Ancient Den, and Great Furnace. If we sacrifice these for value and then copy them for free with Ozgur, since their mana value is 0, we can then use both of them tomorrow to get them back into the graveyard and either keep duplicating them with Ozgur or replaying them with Crucible of Worlds. Notice, one more engine to keep abusing our abilities to get insane mana advantage. Urza's Saga is another land that pairs amazingly well with Crucible of Worlds. It taps for colorless mana, which isn't a problem. However, its second chapter has us creating a huge beater in the form of a Star-Star Construct token. A token with the potential of being doubled or more. Then, it fetches for a 0-costed or 1-costed artifact and gets sacrificed. This artifact is naturally a mana rock, which replaces it. However, we can then replay Urza's Saga with Crucible of Worlds to do it all over again. Same with Inventor's Fair, which is possibly more busted here than Urza's Saga. We're going to very easily be able to activate it and tutor for our library for any artifact we want. In fact, the first artifact we should be tutoring for is Crucible of Worlds. That way we can cast it and then replay Inventor's Fair again. That's what we call a pro gamer move. Walking Atlas, Burnishing Heart, and Solemn Simulacrum are some more artifacts that provide a land-based wrap. Walking Atlas is amazing for when we're drawing into too many lands or use land tax to help us drop an additional land at instant speed or more if we copy it. Burnished Heart and Solemn Simulacrum are pretty obvious in how they accelerate us. Burnished Heart has a built-in sacrifice outlet and then we can replicate it with Ozgur for even more basic lands onto the battlefield, while Solemn Simulacrum also gives us card draw, which helps us not run out of gas. As for actual mana rocks, a huge strength for this deck, it's running Soul Ring, Mana Crypt, Mana Vault, Jeweled Lotus, Mox Opal, Mox Amber, and Arcane Signet. Unfortunately, only Arcane Signet can't be fetched for with Urza's Saga. That being said, if some of these rocks are outside of your budget and you're not playing with proxies or online, you can easily swap them out for the other 2 costed mana rocks and the deck will still run just fine. They're only here due to the synergy with Urza's Saga and Pia's Revolution. We can cast these 0-costed rocks, tap them to pay for Ozgur's sacrifice effect, return it to our hand with Pia's Revolution, then recast it again until we give all of our creatures infinite power. That being said, you can still pull this off with budget substitutes like Boros Signet, Talisman of Conviction, etc. if our cost reduction effects make them cost 0, so no need to worry about the more expensive mana rocks. Jeskai's Will is the final mana acceleration card in the deck and it's too amazing to pass up. Not only do we have the potential of generating a ton of red mana, but we can impulsively draw 3 cards, which can go a long way in a red-white deck. As for the rest of the card advantage, I have mentioned quite often the looting and rummaging effects. Thrill of Possibility, Faithless Looting, Tormenting Voice, Wild Guess, Thrilling Discovery, and Cathartic Reunion are cheap and amazing ways to not only draw cards quickly and efficiently, but also serve as a discard outlet for our more expensive artifacts, so these are pretty straightforward and help out a lot. Memory Jar as well, and it's the only wheel effect in the deck because it doesn't benefit opponents as much as conventional wheel effects do. While it doesn't discard their current hand unless they drew into instants or spells with flash that they can cast before the end of their turn, they're going to lose those 7 new cards. Yet we're able to make the most of it if we cap it when we have an empty hand. We do have to play those cards that turn or discard them, but we can also do this strategically. Oh, and since it's an artifact, it can be further abused with Ozgur. Lashio Clockwork Scholar also synergistically draws us cards, albeit only once per turn. Unfortunately, we can't activate Ozgur or Duretti outside of our turn, but we can Goblin Welder and Felden. So with enough timing, we can draw a card each turn, which is pretty amazing. On top of that, our attacking artifact creatures take no combat damage, which is amazing for our main game plan. Alabu Ancient Witness also provides some form of advantage from our artifact creatures, but they have to essentially be attacking, which is no surprise here, considering they gain haste from it. However, we're able to scry X, where X is the amount of tapped artifacts we have when we attack. This can help us dig deep through our deck. We don't draw, but we can at least leave the card we want on top to later draw into it. If that weren't enough, we can deal that same damage to any target, helping us get rid of pesky creatures or planeswalkers, as well as just sending that pain straight to an opponent's face. Back to actually drawing cards, Mangara the Diplomat also draws us card outside of our turn, with the potential of also drawing us 3 cards between our turns. That's pretty much his entire point of being in the deck, but if we are attacked when we're tapped out, at least we can draw a card off of that happening too. Mila Crafty Companion also draws us cards, but whenever one of our permanents gets targeted by an opponent's spell or ability. If we were to be attacked, then our planeswalkers get a loyalty counter if they're the ones getting attacked. Since the card draw is too situational for my liking, it's not Mila the Face we're going to be casting, but Luka Wayward Bonder instead. He has a rummage effect in his +1, which we've already seen is quite key to the deck's main function. His -2 ability is also amazing in the deck, since we get to reanimate a creature from our graveyard for a 0 mana investment. That creature does get exiled, but not at the end of our turn, at the end of our next upkeep, so it's going to stick around. Then, even if it does get exiled by then, since we can sacrifice it for value first, we can just retrieve it from exile with Proof of Tomorrow. His emblem is also incredibly busted here. Whenever a creature enters the battlefield under our control, it deals damage equal to its power to any target. So any creature we're reanimating or artifact creature we're duplicating with Oscar is already going to be dealing a ton of damage before they even attack. Add to that the artifact creatures that split up when they die and you have quite the engine going. Since he starts off at 5 loyalty, it's pretty easy to get that emblem. It's almost like Luka was designed specifically for this deck. You can even get the emblem faster thanks to Karn's Bastion. There are 3 more planeswalkers in the deck that we already saw. This land enters untapped, taps for mana, and producing colorless isn't an issue for the deck. So even if we play it without any planeswalkers on the battlefield, it doesn't matter. However, once we do get either Karn, Ugin, Duretti, or Luka, then it's going to be epic. Besides all of the synergistic interaction we've already seen so far, there's still plenty more interaction in this deck since Magic the Gathering is in solitaire. Angel of the Ruins, Meteor Golem, and Duplicate are some more artifact creatures that are more for responses than attacking, but they can still be used as beaters in their own right. They're all pretty expensive to cast, but at least the Angel has a built-in discard outlet that also gets you a plane in your hand. A Plains which doesn't have to be basic, by the way, so you can get Mistveil Plains by plane cycling Angel of the Ruins. That being said, imagine activating Osgur on these creatures when you have something like Anointed Procession on the battlefield. Simply glorious. Chaos Warp, Generous Gift, and Wear and Tear are straight-to-the-point removal effects in the deck, and you can't go wrong with these. Every red-white deck should be running them since they're going to get rid of pretty much anything that could be a problem for you, especially in this deck if we're facing Graveyard Hate decks or Stacks decks. As for responses of our own, Boros Charm and Teferi's Protection are similarly ubiquitous and should go in every red-white deck. As I mentioned earlier, all the instants in this deck can be gotten with Sunforger. Of noting is that Teferi's Protection gets exiled upon its resolution, not a problem with Pull from Eternity. We can get it back into our graveyard with it, then bottom deck it with Mistfield Plains to always have Teferi's Protection at the ready. It does protect our tokens, which is kind of important in this deck, so keep this interaction in mind to always have the best protection spell so far at the ready. Champion's Helm, Lightning Greaves, and Swiftfoot Boots are the last pieces of equipment in the deck and are also pretty ubiquitous. Oscar isn't that expensive to cast, but he does have a huge target, so it's smart to protect him. Also, we can duplicate these equipments to protect our other creatures. Keep in mind that we can also swap these around at instant speed with Brass Squire in order to protect any of our creatures from spot removal. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the other lands. The deck's running Plateau, Sacred Foundry, Alpine Meadow, Clifftop Retreat, Command Tower, Reflecting Pool, Battlefield Forge, Ancient Tomb, and Temple of the False God, as well as 5 of each snow-covered basic lands in case anyone's running anything that benefits us for it. Recall that the deck is running a lot of effects that fetch for basics, so having at least 10 of them really help out to maximize those effects. Also recall that the deck's running all 8 fetch lands, all 3 artifact lands, and some other utility lands. As with all of my deck techs, you don't need the more expensive fetch lands or plateau if you're not playing online or proxy them. You can also swap them out for budget substitutes and the deck will still run just fine. This brew is just an idea of how to build around Osgur the Reconstructor. Apart from Essex, Osgur is my favorite commander from the precons. It's incredibly versatile for a red-white deck. While playtesting this deck, the amount of cards you can draw, mana you can generate, and lands you can get onto the battlefield is insane. The deck can complete with plenty of green decks. In power as well, since we can produce a significant amount of fatties. And even then, we can just pump a single or multiple creatures into an insane power. If you're interested in the decklist of the Spicy Brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. Also, a quick shout out to player named Juju, since I had time to do so before I finished recording the video. I know you're building Osgur, so hopefully this video helps you out. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am the Medic Kirby, and happy brewing!